thank you for joining this this webinar. So today I've been given the mission of telling you about AI and how we can use AI for scientific purposes in some HPC context. So I've decided to tell you about some work we did a couple of years ago with colleagues from the US. And so I will tell you about scaling AI for probabilistic programming in scientific simulator. So if you look at today's scientific knowledge, it really spans a full continuum of the length scale. So from, for example, particle physics, which studies really the tiny small with experiments like the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, to cosmology, which studied the very large, like the evolution of the full universe. And in between, we have several other physical sciences, like chemistry, neuroscience, astronomy, weather and climate sciences, and others. And what is common to all these physicals, to all these fields, is that they all now rely on computer simulation to basically describe their theoretical model, right? And so what is common to them is that at the center of this field, there is a simulator, which basically instantiates the knowledge of the field. And the simulator comes with parameters, right? So for example, if you take a cosmological model, you may have a few parameters that you want parameterize the evolution of the universe. Then you can run your simulator forward, and then that would produce observable X, right? So usually it's very easy to go from the left to the right. And so this is what we call prediction. Given some parametrization, some parameters of your scientific model, then you can run your simulator, your simulations, and that would produce observables, right? And you would do it in this way by simply running your computer code, which implements a well-motivated mechanistic and causal model, right? So in probabilistic language, we would say that given some parameters theta, we can sample, we can generate observations through the simulator, right? But as scientists, usually what we want to do is the opposite. So we would have some experiments through which we collect observables, and then we want to do inference. So we want to go in the opposite way from the right to the left. So given some observable X, we want to retrieve the parameters that would agree with this data. So what would be credible parameterization theta for which, if I could run my simulator at these particular values, I would then produce observable X that agree with the actual observations that I collect with my experiments. So this is what we call in usually inference in machine learning or in probabilistic modeling, the fact to go from X to theta. And it's usually difficult because we don't have access to directly to a function that would tell us, huh, this particular X is more likely than this one given some parameterization. And the reason is that the simulator that we've written, that we have in the middle, does not directly provide this function. And this is easy to understand because this simulator is basically written as a composition of microscopic processes that implement your scientific model. And then these microscopic processes get combined into each other through a large simulation to produce some kind of macroscopic object, right? And so if we wanted to basically invert this observation, then we would have to basically consider what are all possible combinations of these microscopic processes that when I combine them together, I obtain the object that I'm starting with, right? So in probabilistic language, what we want to achieve is known as Bayesian inference. And so a simple way to explain Bayesian inference is to say that your simulator is a probabilistic program. And that means if you set some starting parameters theta, and then you let it run, then it will generate random executions. So this is what you see with these lines. They are random executions of your simulator. So you would start with some parameter values, then you would execute your simulator. That would be a random execution of that simulation, and that would generate some final output which correspond to your observation, right? And so so that would correspond to sampling from this joint probability distribution of the parameters. This is the thing that you want to infer, you want to measure, of some latent variables Z that correspond to random processes that are part of your simulation, and X, the final output, the thing that you simulate and you can observe. Now, when you want to do inference, what you are basically asking is, if I condition my simulator to some particular observation X, what would be all the random trajectories, all the random execution of my simulator, which would arrive to this observation, right? And so in if you were to write this in terms of probability distribution, now what we want is to sample from the posterior distribution of the parameters of the random trajectory Z condition on that particular observation, right? So this is the object that we are after very often as scientists when we say that we want to do inference. So there are different techniques that you can use to solve this problem. In the case where your simulation is in the case where your heuristic model is implemented as a simulator. So traditional methods, maybe some of you know about them, are, for example, approximate Bayesian computation. But recently, with the rise of machine learning and deep learning, there has been new methods, some of them we've developed in our group, that make use of these models of neural networks to basically solve that same problem, but in a way which is much more efficient. So you have techniques like neural likelihood ratio estimation, neural posterior estimation, learning summary statistics of the data, sequential methods. But today what I want to tell you about is a family of methods which is known as probabilistic programming. So probabilistic programming is basically a machine learning framework which allows you to write programs that define probabilistic models. So it's like regular programs that you would write in Python or in C++, except that now some of their variables are also random variables in their statistical sense. So they have a type, as in a regular programming language, but they are also random. So that means you can sample, you can generate realizations for these random variables. And when you have a full program written in this way, you can also condition on some particular realizations of these random variables, right? And so these frameworks, they also provide you with the capability of running automated Bayesian inference, which is this problem that I described just before, of parameters conditioned on observed outputs. And so if you are using, for example, modern probabilistic programming languages like Pyro, Edward, or Stan, this is something which you can do quite easily. And because you, as a scientist, the only thing that you would have to do is to describe your forward process as a probabilistic program, and then you could, out of the box, run some inference engine to solve this problem. The issue with these frameworks is that basically they require you to implement your simulator from scratch in these languages, right? So if I have, for example, some particle physics simulation and I would like to do probabilistic programming in this context, I would have to rewrite my simulator in one of these systems. And this is too bad because these simulators, they exist. They are the output of decades of development by scientists, and we don't want to rewrite everything from scratch. So the key idea that we had in this work was to observe that actually many HPC simulators are also stochastic, and they define probabilistic models by sampling random numbers. So that means concretely that scientific simulators are already probabilistic programs. Every time you have a scientific simulator in which you are simulating a random process and in which very concretely you have to draw random numbers, that means this piece of code is a probabilistic program. Okay? And so That means we could run inference on these programs. The only thing we need, and this is easy to say, but not so easy to do, is to basically have an infrastructure that we could use to execute this scientific simulator as probabilistic program. And this is what we've done in this work. And so the framework that we have developed is called PyProb, and you can view that as a new probabilistic programming system for simulator in HPC, and it is a framework which is based on PyTorch. All right, so how does it work? It involves two steps. The first step is to run your simulator forward. So you would basically run your simulator many times, and every time the code that you execute has to draw a random number, you would catch all these random choices. So you basically hook to each of the code that you make to random number generators, and you would record the execution trace that you generate. And by that I mean you would record all parameters, all realizations of the parameters, all the random choices that you make when you execute your simulator forward, and finally the output that you generate, right? And we represent this execution as what we call an execution trace, which is basically a whole sequence of all these things. And so this is what is shown also here. Each one of the nodes corresponds to a call to your random number generator, and when and where it happened in the execution trace. So this may seem quite complicated, but actually it's not the case. We have written an execution protocol which allows you to basically just replace the calls that you would make to random number generators, and that's it. That's the only thing you have to do. You don't have to change the entire code base. Then what we want to do is to run inference. And to do that, we would have to basically approximate the distribution of parameters and the distribution of latent variables, all these random choices, to produce or explain some observed data that we are interested in or that we've collected in an experiment. And so this is something you can do with inference engines like Markov chain Monte Carlo. However, this is typically very hard and computationally very costly, because if you were to run MCMC on these kind of simulators, you would need to run it up to millions of times. So that's a first problem that maybe you can solve with HPC. But the second issue, which is more fundamental, is that these inference engines are sequential. So you can only generate one posterior trace, one after the other. You cannot generate several in parallel. And so that means it becomes much more complicated to make use of the HPC resources that you may have. Also, MCMC comes with other problems like burning and autocorrelation. Well, the good news is that now we are in 2021, and deep learning has proven its use and efficiency, and we can also make use of deep learning in this context. And in particular, what we can do is that we can amortize the cost of inference using deep learning or using deep neural networks. So how does that work? Well, basically what we did was to generate many execution traces, which would basically correspond to recording the behavior of the simulator. And so that's something you can do, for example, by distributing the generation of these execution traces using your HPC cluster. You just run your simulator many, many times in parallel. That produces a bunch of execution traces. And then the thing that we want to train, the kind of neural network that we want to train, is a neural network that would basically learn this simulator, or basically would learn how to reproduce the execution traces that you feed to this network as training data, right? And so we would have a deep recurrent neural network in this case that would learn all random choices in the simulator. Technically, the kind of neural network that we have is dynamic in the sense that it would grow with the complexity of the simulator. We would have layers that get created as we learn more of the simulator. And typically, at least for the proof of principle that we did, we had a neural network made of millions of parameters. So this is still very costly, but what is now different is that it is amortized. You only need to train this neural network once, and once you have done that, you can do inference on several observations. While, for example, if you were to do MCMC, you would have to run MCMC from scratch for every observations for which you want to do inference. Here we just train it once, and when it's trained, it's amortized, meaning now we'll be able to do inference very fast. All right, so how do we do inference now that we've built this neural network? Well, basically, we would have our trained deep neural network, and we would use it to make intelligent choices given data observation. And so the way it works is that instead of running your original code base, your original simulator, and following the random choices that are implemented in the code, what you would do is that you would execute your simulator, and then every time you encounter a call to your random number generator, you would not call this random number generator, but you would ask the neural network, hey, what's the random distribution I should actually draw from if I wanted to, at the end of my execution trace, reproduce this observed data, right? And so you would be basically delegating all random choices to the neural network. And then the neural network then would draw a random number for you. You would put it back into your simulator and then continue the execution forward until you arrive to the observation, right? And so this is something now which is nice because you can distribute inference. You can generate this posterior execution traces in parallel because you can just instantiate this neural network on many machines if you have some. And which is quite different from MCMC, in which you generate these execution traces one after the other because they are dependent by design. So another way to view that is with this figure that you see. So in orange, you would have the original simulator, right? And on top, you would have the probabilistic programming system, which is controlled by the neural network. And what you would have is basically some kind of puppet master analogy, where the puppet master would be basically controlling what should the simulator do, right? And this is what would happen when you divert basically the calls to random number to the random number generators back to the neural network, would produce some values that would then inject back into the simulation. So if we want to zoom in on how it works, I think this is a nice figure. So what you have at the bottom is the neural network, which in this case is a multi-layer LSTM, some kind of recurrent neural network that takes as input the observed data, right? And then what you do is that you start your simulation, and then every time you hit a call to the random number generator, this call is identified by some unique address in the execution trace, right? And so this is what you pass as input to the network. You pass the address of the current call to the random number generator, together with the observable that you want to generate. And then for each of these calls, the recurrent neural network is basically telling you, you should actually draw a random number, not from the original distribution, but from this distribution, right? Then you draw a random number from it. That gives you this value, which you then inject back into the simulation. And then you continue forward until you produce the final output. Right. So this works, and so the use case that we consider is the case of the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, the LHC, and we wanted basically to invert the generation process, which is implemented currently in particle physics simulation. So the LHC, the scientific purpose of the LHC is basically to seek to uncover secrets of the universe. And one way they want to do that is by, for example, discovering new particles, for example, the Higgs boson, which they discovered in 2012, also to just refine the current knowledge of particle physics by making more accurate measurements, which means basically to do inference on some parameters of the standard model of particle physics, right? And so today, physicists, what they do is that they compare pieces of data, so the collision that they collect with this experiment that they've built, to detailed simulations, and they do that using a large farm of computers. Billions of CPU hours are basically spent for scanning simulation parameters and then comparing the output to the actual data that they collect with the experiment. So this is quite inefficient. This is labor intensive, and it's also sometimes quite ad hoc in the way in the methodology that they use. Instead, with this work, so with PyProp, what we do is that we replace all this thing with automated and efficient inference, which is grounded in a proper statistical frame. So the thing that we'll do is that we'll basically express physics in terms of simulator code. And what we've done is that we base our proof of principle on Sherpa, which is a particle physics simulator of more or less of more than 1 million lines of C++ code. And we just let it run. We recorded execution traces, which in our case then represent particle physics collisions and how these particles also decay into other particles, like electrons or muons flying out of the collision and interacting with the materials of the detector. And so in a probabilistic model, then what we have is this kind of model, which represents a particle physics, the particle physics simulation. And so we have some kind of state machine, or where each node represents a call to basically represent a sampling statement, so a call to the random number generator. And you have several paths along this diagram, which represent possible executions, possibly going through cycles of random executions of the simulator, right? And so if you run it forward, at the end, what you would basically produce are simulated output of the detector of the experiment. And so in this case, we can simulate the what is called a calorimeter, which is some kind of camera that is able to measure electric charges of the outgoing particles. So this is the observables that we expect to see in the actual experiment. And then we want to do inference. So we want to see, given these particular observations, what could be all possible execution traces that would lead to this one, right? And so among all random choices, some are more important than others because they represent physical quantities that in this case physicists are interested in. And so like the momentum of the particles and the decay channel and all these things. But what is interesting with this diagram is that this is quite interpretable for physicists because this process represents their own simulator, which they have written. So they understand quite well what that means. And so that then give them a way to basically have stories or compatible scenarios of how this particular observation could have been generated under their model. And so this is a simplified view. Of course, the simulator is more complicated, but PyProb basically gives access to all latent variables of the probabilistic model. So in this case, we don't have 20 or so calls to the random number generator. We have thousands of them, and we can do posterior inference for each of them. And so this is what you see there in this plot. So this is nice because that allows answering any model-based question. All right, so now this is also a talk about HPC. So to make this work, we actually had to train and to train this neural network and to generate data using HPC resources. So we had to reach a supercomputing scale. So we were bringing together probabilistic programming, simulation, and supercomputing, and we really needed HPC resources because we had considerable optimization to solve, both when it came to generate the data, so just running the simulation forward, and also training the neural network. So the platform that we were lucky to have access to were supercomputers in the US at Berkeley. So we partnered with Intel and NERSC, So we had access to Cori and Edison, which are gigantic HPC resources. And this allowed us to basically scale to show that this system could scale quite well. So we tested our system on two of these computers, on Cori and Edison, and we tested from one to one. So in the case where we train on and use the system using only one node, up to 1,000 of them. And you see that the throughput that we managed to achieve, I mean, it's not ideal. It's not perfect, but it's already quite reasonable, in particular on this infrastructure, on the Edison computer system, where the average throughput was not that far from the ideal throughput. In terms of number, just to give you an impression of how large this thing needed to be, so the neural network that we train was made of 170 million parameters, so it's a very large recurrent neural network. We generated a data set of 15 million random executions for a total of almost 2 terabytes of data. We train this neural network using fully synchronous data parallel training on about 1,000 nodes for a total of 30,000 CPUs. And we did that using PyTorch and using PyTorch MPI, which is basically a bridge between a standard MPI that you have in HPC and PyTorch. We had a global mini batch size of 128,000, which is quite large. Usually when you train neural networks, you use a mini batch of maybe 100, 200, but not something that large. And overall, we showed that the speed up that we reach was around 14,000, going from minutes if we had to train the system on a single machine, going from months to minutes. So that's quite good and impressive. All right, so this is nice, but remember, the purpose of all this is that we want to do inference. So we want to go backwards. So given some observations, we want to find plausible parameter values, right? And so this is what we indeed managed to do in the case of particle physics using this particular simulator. So if you feed some particular observation and then just let the distributed inference engine run, we were able to show that the posterior that then we retrieve is compatible with obtain using standard MCMC kind of inference engine. So this is nice because this is actually the first example of a tractable Bayesian inference for particle physics, which gives scientists full access to the posterior and also to be able to interpret how these observations could have been made in their own model. So this is really not a black box at all, because everything can be interpreted in the original simulation code. So to summarize, I would say that PyProbe is a probabilistic software framework which you can use to execute and control existing HPC simulator code base. So this is quite important. You don't have to rewrite everything from scratch. You can use the simulator that you already have. You would just basically control them now with a neural network in order to do inference. Synchronous data parallel training of a neural network was in this case made possible thanks to HPC. If we had not access to this kind of resources, I don't think we would have been able to show that this is something that can be done. And finally, AI-powered probabilistic programming was shown in this work. What was shown in this work for the first time to be practical for large-scale real-world science models. So this is really not a toy model. It's really an actual scientific model used in particle physics. So I think this is quite promising, because this is something we could also do in many other physical sciences, like the one that I've shown at the beginning of this talk. Finally, I would like to also thank all my collaborators. So this is not only my work, this is really a team effort with colleagues from CERN, from Oxford, from New York University, and from Berkeley, NERSC, and Intel.